Beloved, I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You are listening to Pastor Dieudonné Manzambi of the Heads of Promises Sanctuary, Johannesburg. Let us go straight to the Word of God. God has laid a message on my heart that really I want to give it to you as it was given to me. So let us read the book of Mark, chapter 4, verse 35 to 40. We started last week. The Bible says, on the same day, when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him, and they said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Then he arose, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Why are you so fearful? Why is it that you have no faith? The title of my message is Cross Over to the Other Side. Beloved, there is another side to the situation you may be going through. You may have been stuck in I don't know which condition for years. It may seem quite impossible for you to move forward. But I want to tell you that there is another side. You have not yet seen all what God is able to do. No matter how prosperous has been your journey with the Lord, no matter how successful you have been, let me tell you, there is another side. There is a side of God you have never seen, you have never heard about. Our God is beyond comprehension. Our God is beyond human imagination. He is beyond what any human brain can handle. He is exalted above all you have seen, all you have heard. If he can restore sight to the blind, he can recreate any damaged organ in your body. If he can give life to the dead, he can resurrect any dead dream you may have. He can reshape your future. There is another side. So no human situation is so hopeless that it goes beyond the reach of the Almighty God. It is said about the Apostle John that a Roman emperor commanded that he may be put in boiling oil till death. But he came out alive and he was still able to preach the gospel. He was forced to drink poison, but it didn't harm him. Why? He serves a God who's beyond measure, beyond comprehension. He managed to survive all those problems. God has not yet finished with you either. Expect Him to take you abundantly, exceedingly, beyond your thoughts and beyond your prayers. God is not limited to what we ask or we think about. Never become so accounted to God that you think that you know everything about Him. You have not yet seen all what God is able to do. Don't think that you know enough about Him in a way that you can predict His next move. Never think about God in human terms. He is far beyond. There is another side. Don't limit God to what you know. Don't limit God to what you have been told. Don't limit God to whatever you have heard. God is always more. There is another side to your health condition. There is another side to your financial situation. There is another side to your social plight. Allow only God to have the last say in whatever you are going through. So Jesus told his disciples, "Let us cross and go to the other side." The longing of my heart this morning, the longing of my heart, wherever you are listening to me, is that you may hear the voice of God prompting you to cross over to the other side. There is more in God than what you know. There is more in Him than what you have heard. There is more in Him than what you think. Beloved, last time we spoke about heavenly adoration. We spoke about heavenly worship. John saw the throne of God. He saw four living creatures around the throne and 24 elders. And day and night, those living creatures, they said, "Holy, holy, holy God Almighty." And the 24 elders cast down their crowns. Each time the living creatures look at God, they see in Him something they never saw before. And this has been going on forever and ever. God is holy, holy, holy. This reflects His eternal nature, His divine perfection, His supreme holiness. God is beyond what you can imagine. So, beloved, learn to worship God. If you learn to worship God, your prayer will change because your understanding of God will change also. So Jesus told His disciples, "Let us go to the other side." God sees what me and you, we cannot see. God knows what we don't know. He knows that there is another side. I'm speaking to believers and unbelievers. I'm speaking to the learned and the unlearned. I'm speaking to the clergy and to the congregation. I'm speaking to the fortunate and the destitute. Cross over to the other side. The one who sent me to tell you those words, he just told me, tell them, cross over to the other side. I'm talking to anyone in a desperate situation. I'm speaking to someone who has a social condition that has not improved for years. I am addressing anyone who's drowning in debt or financial problems. I'm talking to someone sinking in sin. I'm talking to someone drowning in drug addictions. I'm talking to someone with an incurable disease. I'm talking to someone with cancer. I'm talking to someone in a terminal stage of his disease. I'm talking to anyone to whom the hospital has said, just go. We have done for you all we could. There is another side. I am addressing anyone who wants to hear the voice of God this morning. I'm talking even to somebody in a palliative care because he is beyond medical rescue. I'm talking to a person who is desperate. Jesus is telling you, let us go to the other side. He didn't say go to the other side. He said, let us go to the other side. It means he's prepared to start and accomplish this journey with you. Some people have known you for long. They cannot imagine or see you beyond the situation where you have been. Who cares? Listen to the voice of the Master who's telling you, cross to the other side. God wants to take you in a land where you have never been, a territory you have never visited. There is another side. And I thank God deeply for the other side. So in Mark 4, verse 35, the text we read, it starts with those words, on the same day. So for a better comprehension, for a better understanding of what will follow, we need to know what happened that day. Mark 4, verse 2, the Bible says, he told them many things in parables. So that day, Jesus told them many things in parable. What is a parable? A parable is a story taken from everyday life situation, but that has a profound spiritual meaning. So he taught them many things in the parable. And the purpose of those parables was to teach them how the kingdom of God operates. The kingdom of God operates on laws. There are laws that govern the kingdom of God. In verse 3, we see he's talking about a sower who went out to sow a seed. In verse 26, he spoke about the kingdom of God. He said, once the seed has been put in the ground, it will grow. You don't know how. In verse 30, he said that the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. No matter how small it is, the harvest will be huge. So his purpose was to unveil to them the mysteries of the kingdom of God, how the kingdom of God operates. A mystery is a hidden truth. Now he's unveiling to them hidden truth in the word of God. So he spoke about the soul who is scattering seed. We see that from verse 3 to verse 9. And in verse 9, he ended his discourse by this sentence: who has ear to hear, let him hear. What does it mean? He is telling them, listen, pay close attention to what I'm about to tell you. Pay close attention. Pay close attention. At the end of a difficult saying or parable, Jesus used to say those words to call people to pay careful heed to what he has said. So this is very important to understand the parable of the sower. He said some seed fell on the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them. Some seed fell on a stony ground. It didn't have much earth. Immediately, the seed sprang out. But when the sun was up, it was scorched and dried because it didn't have enough earth. Other fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked the seed, and the seed could not yield any crop. Other seed fell on good ground. I want you to notice that in this parable, the word seed is singular. Nowhere you will find him talking about seeds. He spoke about seed. Ask by the disciple to explain to them, what is the meaning of this parable? Jesus said that the sower sows the word. So the word of God is the seed. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 23 says, the word of God is a corruptible seed. It is a seed that will never decay. The kingdom of God operates on the principle of seed, as we saw it in Genesis chapter 8, verse 22. As the earth remains, there will be seed time harvest. There is always a seed time and harvest. Seed time and harvest. Any human need has a corresponding seed in the word of God. Instead of you being need-minded, Jesus wants you to be seed-minded. Psalm 107 verse 17 says to verse 20, some become fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquity. Their soul abhorred all manner of meat. They draw near unto the gates of death. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. How did he save them? The Bible said, he sent out his word and healed them and restored them from the grave. He saved them by the word. He healed them, he delivered them by the word. So the Bible you are holding contains seed. The Bible contains deliverance seed. The Bible contains prosperity seed. The Bible contains healing seed. The Bible contains breakthrough seed. Any human need has a seed in the Word of God. There is no problem that is without a corresponding seed in the Word of God. You need to go to the Bible, you need to find it. But the problem is the soil where the seed is planted. The seed needs to be planted in good soil. The seed needs to be planted in good soil. Proverbs 4, verse 23, the Bible says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. So life springs from the heart of man. Your life will spring from your own heart. I'm not talking about the organ that pumps blood. I'm talking about the true you. From your heart, your life will spring. From your heart to heart, from your heart, your life will spring. So the heart is the inner man. The heart is the spring, the spirit of a man. That is where the word of God needs to be rooted. But the heart needs preparation. The heart needs plowing. The heart needs to be fit to receive the seed. The word of God in you, hate, gives you knowledge, but the word of God in your heart gives faith. What you know in your head can be unknown in your heart. What you know in your head can be unknown in your heart. And the way to get into your spirit, where it is designed to be, you need to meditate on the word of God. That's how the word of God will reach your heart. So he spoke about few kinds of grounds. The first preparation for a heart is to be born again. So there are few type of ground. The first ground is the wayside. This is unprepared ground, unplowed soil. The seed cannot germinate because the soil is hard. And the birds came, took out the seed. This is somebody who hears the word of God, but does not understand the word immediately. Satan will come and steal the word. He spoke about the stony ground. This is a partially prepared ground, but stones were not taken out. Those seeds sprang out quickly, but had no root. And when the sun arose, the plant dried up. Those are people who receive the word of God gladly. They are excited when they hear the word of God. But when tribulation, when persecution arose because of the word of God, they forget the word because they don't have root in themselves. I want you to note that persecution and tribulation will arise because of the word of God. So a stony heart is a rigid heart. This is a cold heart. This is a heart that does not accept change. Beloved, your breakthrough awaits you. other side. When you accept the word of God to break through your heart, that way is your breakthrough. Don't have a cold heart, a rigid heart, like a stone that cannot be moved. Some people, they are just like that. They are being set, they cannot move. How does a heart become stony? A heart can become stony because of trials, disappointment, hardship. People, they make stand decision from what they went through. The other thing that harden a heart is sin. Sin will make your heart cold. A wounded heart as well can become cold, a stony heart. Another partially prepared ground is what the Bible calls among thorns. Those are people where the cares of this world, the deceitful of riches, and desire of other things will choke the word of God. The cares, people are worried, they are consumed, anxious about material things. Beloved, I want you to understand that your life does not depend on your possession. Your life depends on God. Don't allow riches to deceive you. Riches gives promises they cannot keep. Riches will deceive you. Money will blind you. Your riches are not a sign of your communion with God. Don't think because you have more, you are more close to God than somebody who has less. That's what the Bible is talking about, deceitfulness of riches and the desire of other things. It means wherever you are having a strong desire from something, it can even be a good thing. But never allow that desire to blind you toward the word of God. Jesus is saying, if you can receive the word of God as a seed in your heart, a heart that has been prepared, you make sure that you took stones from your heart. You make sure that you took thorns from your heart. That seed will grow. That seed will lead and increase. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. May God bless you mightily. To God be the glory. Amen, amen. I love you. See you next time.